Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of CDAC. We are doing group stage number two as we are going into our second game and our final game of the day. The way we do it is a best of one. We do two of them every single day for the next 2 days, including today is 3 days in total. And then we see who are the top two teams. They then advance themselves through into the double elimination playoff, where they already got four of the greatest teams from China awaiting to play them. So let's get ourselves into this game. We've got a team which most people won't know. In fact, I should say all people that will be watching this live stream will not know, and that is Happy Boys. Happy Boys in the world. They are going to be playing on the diet side for this game. They came in through the open qualifier, so nobody actually understands who the hell these guys are. And then LGD. LGD second squad, LGD CDEC, are playing in this competition as well. LGD CN is already qualified directly into the main, event, so maybe we have LGD versus LGD during the first round. Either way, LGD will try as a second squad to prove they also deserve a slot. They must take one of the top two positions, though, in order to get it. So, yeah, for now, into the draft we head, and we'll give ourselves some in-game sounds as Happy Boys in the world. They're going to start off with a Doombringer first ban, and I would say that's a surprise, but it's not really a surprise. Doombringer is the hero which everyone is just loving of late. The Brewmaster and the Nyx Assassin will also be banned out. Now, Nyx Assassin is a little bit more of a uncharacteristic ban, because you don't normally look and say, yeah, we'll take out the Nyx Assassin, because they're definitely going to pick that one. Nyx Assassin's completely dropped off the scene recently. He's sometimes good up against like these mana burn, like up against heroes with really low mana pools. Heroes like Brewmaster, for example, actually really struggle playing up against Nyx Assassin in the early stages, at least, until like bottle charges and wand charges can really start to kick in. So yeah, it's one of these things where
Radiant
I'm interested to see why they're banning out that Nyx Assassin, if there's a secret strat behind this or something. And they go with the Lycan. Terrain Protector was banned out by Happy Boys in the world, so maybe we see a quick push game. Batrider again is able to slip through, and maybe that could have been it too. If they were to pick up both Lycan as well as Batrider, they would have been so happy with life. But the Nyx Assassin, I kind of forget about it, because we don't see Batrider as much anymore. But Nyx Assassin is still like one of the greatest counters for both Timbersaur as well as Batrider, because you just jump yourself in with the Spike Carapace into the middle of the Firefly, so that basically stops the attack straight away. Because it's like, what are you gonna do? You can't run away because you get instantly silent. Unless you have a BKB or immunity, you cannot get yourself away in that
Radiant
scenario.
Team.
And the Timbersaw can't Timber Chain himself away because he does damage straight away. That's the reason for that. Okay, so Lycan, Rubick will be the two pickups here from CDEC. It's not a full push. Like, if it's a full push, I'll be looking for like Lushrak to come in from LGD. They could still do that. It will be the combo hero to go with the Rubick. But I was thinking more like Lushrak plus an extra jungle hero, like an early Enchantress or something along these lines. And then you could really add a lot of early game pressure. But they're not going to. Ancient Apparition and Batrider already there for Happy Boys. Not the greatest, well, I say not the greatest early game fighters. With Chilling Touch, AA makes everyone else the greatest early game fighters. Batrider, he's kind of like just a Firefly at the early stages, and that's really it. He can try and stick a Napalm, but only if he has a favorable matchup. As in, he's just trading blows with an enemy hero. That's the way he could do that one. The Enchantress is actually now being banned out by Happy Boys, so they're thinking the same thing as I am. If LGD just try and force this, with the Rubick, I suppose in a way, like, it's still, like, it gives you your disable, your control, there's some really great abilities to steal as well once it gets level 6. And the early pushing power from Lycan and Enchantress would have been enough that they could have just forced out the towers. I also want to give a huge shout out to those guys that actually did stick around. Somehow we went from 16,000 viewers to 3.6k. So shout out to everyone who is still tuning in. And there's those loyalists to the joined little live stream. I hope you do enjoy the coverage we pump out here. Coming on the weekends, you know, thought, do some nice games for you. And we're going to be here for the playoffs. Make sure you also do tune in. We will be doing the playoffs. BTS is also meant to be streaming side by side with us. Obviously not a partnership, it's just we both got rights for it. So, yeah.
Dire team
I would love your selection choice. Clockwork is now going to be the fourth ban out here from LGD. I'm just thinking it's full on, like, I would say Team Global or Jump In ability kind of, like, lineup. That could be it. Puck will be the final ban out from Happy Boys,
Dire
so they might be worried this is all a bit of a show, and it's all about like control.
Dazzle.
That's all. So
Radiant team
Dazzle will now be the Next pick up and Wraith King. Now you understand the Knicks ban. I knew something would fly during this draft that would explain the reason why they wanted to remove the Knicks assassin. And that is it. Faces Void and Clockwork also. Clockwork can burn off the mana of Wraith King. And Faces Void, like, you can make that Wraith King ulti basically mean nothing to anybody. A good position Chronosphere, and he'll just kill him off again. So Dazzle as well as Ancient Apparition. This allows Happy Boys, if they want to, that they could try and go for an aggro lane. The synergy between both Dazzle as well as AA isn't really that great as far as...
Radiant team pick.
Okay. I'm going to finish my thought first on the AA and the Dazzle before I get to the Brusa back. The synergy between the AA and the Dazzle isn't really that fantastic. Like, a Rubick and an AA works really well together because you know you're able to get your cold feed off. Dazzle and Ancient Apparition, what it turns into is this range spam damage. Between Poison Touch and the Chilling Touch, you're just having like to spam people from range. Remaining. So that you basically win by harassment with these two support heroes. Remaining. And you normally stay alive long enough, of course, you got Dazzle. Now, the synergy I was looking for was with some kind of then like hero which would either keep up with their range damage or would be able to follow up with a straight up stun, like a lock on stun. And the primary reason why that would be like the thing I'm looking for is because that at least lets you win your aggro tri lane or win your off lane. Because it's a Brusselback pickup now, I know he's been playing the number one position, and I'd be really depressed if they do take him towards the top lane here, Happy Boys. They could run him aggro tri lane and put him really in the front lines up against the Lycan. With the Dazzle and the AA, both Dazzle and Bristleback destroy off the Lycan wolves. They're perfect for this kind of stuff. And Rubick in the early stage just really can't do anything against it either.
10 seconds remaining.
I like the pickup. What I'm worried about is what's going to happen with the Wraith King. Because he's going to die and then reincarnate up. It's going to slow the Bristleback and it takes away all of the Quill charges you've already built up. Now, you've already got, like, your Warpath charges, which will still mean you have the damage, but you won't be able that instant pop damage you're searching for on the Wraith King. And that's kind of, like, what I was thinking would be, like, a critical point
10 seconds
to their lineup, to make sure they can bring down that core. That is, in fact, if that is a core Wraith King.
5 seconds remaining.
All right, so Darkseer, Wraith King, and Rubick.
Serve time.
And the Lycan. It's not full push power. It kind of feels like more of a timing style push coming out from LGD. I'm liking Happy Boys lineup a lot more. They can dictate the timing of it all more than anything else. Like the Battle Rider, when he gets his Blink Dagger, be good to go. Up against the Darkseer, he'll be fine. Because it's like just Firefly. Darkseer's actually gonna have himself a good time. Buy a stick early on. Just head north, and hope he gets 1-on-1 with Bat Rider. LGD have the other option as well, depending on who the mid solo is. It takes out the Viper, they take out the Weaver. If it was a Weaver aggro tri lane, they could run like Weaver, Rubick, Wraith King top, Darkseer bottom, and Lycan in the mid. But they need to know who from Happy Boys is going in the middle lane, which means LGD are going to be really happy that they have the last and final say here in the draft. So Happy Boys have to reveal their final hero. It would normally be a mid solo hero here unless they plan to put the Bat Rider there, and it's an Alchemist. Okay,
Radiant team.
I wonder if Happy Boys are trying to take the gamble right now that is a Lycan in the middle lane. Because if it's a Lycan in the middle lane, even then I'm not quite so sure about this, because, what works nicely is when Alchemist hits his level 6. Once he hits level 6, he's really freaking good, because he just sits there and goes, hey, now I can just regenerate straight back up again, there's not much you can do, your harassment damage doesn't really mean that much. And as the spray becomes a buffer for him in the early game to get him to that point. But Lycan is also one of these heroes which has a lot of life points when it comes to level 6 and a lot of damage in LGD. Yes! Yes! I love it when we get this hero! Sorry. I should explain that kind of outburst. As far as Pugna goes, I'm a massive fan of Pugna lineups because you can tell 20 minutes into the game if you've won or if you've lost. That's it. That's the beauty of the Pugna. He's a wonderful hero for a caster to commentate. He's great at teamfight control. Bristleback's going to find himself actually damaging himself a lot with that consistent spray out. He's always going to get hit by that Nether Ward. Dazzle as well as Ancient Apparition also burned through a lot of their mana early on. And it's also a bit of like an early warning system. You see where the Netherworld actually burns. So if you get the vision of that, then you'll know where the Batrider is coming in from. So all of these things together makes me a huge fan of a hero like a Pugna. And of course his ability just to force out the towers early on.
Prepare for battle.
Me is probably almost the bigger thing. You're able to push in early, which means you get a lot of early money as well. So because you get this early cash coming in from the towers, heroes like Lycan can build into bigger items faster. And then also have more space being created on their lanes that they can go to work. So our lanes will be pretty standard here. We'll have 333 going towards the top lanes, the Darks here for LGD. It's going to be a Lycan in the middle lane, and that puts Wraith King support. He's got Pugna down here as well, going as the core. And then the final one will be the Rubick support. Off lane will be Batrider, so it looks like Batrider versus Darkseer will not be the matchup. And we don't see an aggro tri lane, so I can be sad. But Luffy will be up on this top lane going up against the Darkseer. Now, this is the reason why I wasn't a fan of this lane. It's because the Iron Shell is really going to cause problems for this guy, this Darkseer. I mean, where he goes. I will follow you, man. I will follow you. Welcome to the snail trail. Wherever this guy goes, yeah. Darkseer is going to cause him problems. And the primary reason is because of Iron Shell. He has to come in close to battle up against it. So once the levels come up a little bit higher, it's going to like start to eat away his life points. And then Dazzle's going to be using his mana, not for harassment, but for life. Keep on using that Shadow Wave of his, as opposed to just like harassing all the time with Poison Touch. Now, rune's going to spawn on bottom, possibly the nicest one too. A double damage rune to come in for the Wraith King. They're not going to get a kill on the Batrider. He went Firefly level 1. So, unless they can... Ooh, okay. If Batrider walks past here, it's the line I'm going to draw right now. See it time and time again. If he walks past that point, then Rubick Telekinesis, as well as Hellfire Blast, will be able to control him. Now, he's sitting on the edge. Now, does he come down is the question. He's close to it. The problem is for him... Like, he can see the Wraith King, like, okay, the good thing for him is he can see the Wraith King. That's not a problem, it's a good thing. He can see the Wraith King. With Mr. Monopoly Ward, you see him perfectly. Now, Dark's here on the top lane. Okay, this is not the way this lane was meant to go for him. He's getting nasal gooed. How many Bristlebacks at level 1 will level up nasal goo? Most of the time, you're looking for your quill damage, or you're looking for, like your back to be buffed up, because then, like, any kind of harassment damage, you just take it. But going up against a Darkseer, obviously having the Bristleback ability isn't going to help you because you've always got your front to the Iron Shell. And even then, it's like, okay, yeah, not a fun thing. Now he's got the backup. But he's got no Quill Spray. So he's got no way to like stack up the damage against him. Realize too, we're still sorted by our teams. And this is that Alchemist little buffer I was talking about. I was actually interested to see how he would approach this. As far as like the Alchemist goes, because it's been a while since we've seen a lot of Alchemist play. Most of the time, like in the past when Alchemist like started to fade off, it was Acid Spray as well as Concoction was maxed as high as you could possibly get it. Like, that was the primary goal of the Alchemist. He was a filter with his Acid Spray, and he was a, oh, hello. You have no points up in Napalm, you can't get this kill. Talking to the Batrider. But yeah, with the Acid Spray as well as the Concoction, you just search for the kills early on. But it kind of relies on rotating supports. Because you can have like your high points up in Acid Spray, which will now like zone out like the walls, for example. But the primary problem you're then going to hit... Why is Pugna so low? Creep Wave's under the tower and like there's no one else here. Okay, he must just be waiting it out so he can use his salve. Oh, there it is. Yeah, but with like the Acid Spray Concoction, like you get a lot of early damage, but you need to have a combo hero with this. And this is like a stunner or your straight up burst damager. Now, you don't have a burst damager because you've got Ancient Apparition and Dazzle. And I'm not going to count really the heal as a form of burst damage, because if you're throwing out Concoction as well as like your Acid Spray, you're going to take a while before you can walk in close enough to the target you're initiating on. Unless he's really stupid enough to be close when this kind of stuff happens. Like, okay, like Concoction, that's just basic harassment because he has mana to do so. But this is great. This is better from LGD. Like, they're like, okay, Acid Spray is still down, sure. But they have a Wraith King as well as a Rubick.
Radiant's middle tower.
These two guys are great at killing. One controller with a nuke. Okay, he doesn't have a nuke. Okay, maybe it's a little bit premature. And we have a level 2 Wraith King, and he put a point up into stats. So they're looking for someone to come Dyer's to the bottom lane. Right, the other lane didn't work. Is this a level 1 blast? It's a level 2 nether blast. Damage to the tower's not as high as I remember it being. Triple 3 as he farms up the jungle. Okay, now they found someone. So it was Batrider on the side. He's got boots first, so the chance of actually catching him is minimal. Rubik, like, he was in range almost for a telekinesis. So they're just trying to keep him back. Like, if he comes to fight, then they turn and fight. Like, they'll decrepify him, they'll hellfire blast him, they'll do whatever they possibly can. They've already managed to force up the fortification, the town's on a half-life. Now, this Pugna wants to get at least a couple more creeps here, because once he has mana boots, this harassment will continue all the time. And the towers in the bottom lane will go until H-Boys rotate a hero down to defend this. Okay, now he can pick up Arcane Boots, he should walk over and get it. Because this is also an activator for heroes like Wraith King as well as the Rubik. Darkseer, okay, confidence from him. He gets poisoned up and just surges away. But he grabs a creep wave and at least drags it back. So he'll defend his own tier 1 tower. Now Arcanes, yeah, they're up. So Blast, and then Arcane Boot charges up. Hellfire Blast going as well. So Batrider held out, but they do bring in the Alchemist. With a Haste Rune, he's going to keep this chase going. The Nether Ward does come down. Well, that's actually a really nice Nether Ward. But because of that Alchemist, he's already out of mana. The Batrider has already used his Firefly too. So they're just going to hold back. They start to regenerate up, and Ancient Apparition goes down behind the tower. So while all that engagement was going on, the Lycan just pops his ultimate form and dives an Ancient Apparition. Of course, with the Alchemist TPing out of the middle lane, it bought a lot of space for that to happen then. It's kind of funny because I really wasn't expecting an Ancient Apparition to die to a Lycan in the mid. As I was talking about, like, Alchemist, dude, like, wouldn't give a crap about it, but Ancient Apparition, when he tries to sit there and soak up the experience so he can get towards his level 6 up against a level 7 Lycan, yeah, he deserves to die. The bottom tower, come on, where's that Pugna Blast? You gotta get it in there. He's trying to actually clarity up. He's got Arcane Boots off cooldown, but I think he's trying to wait for, okay, yeah, I think he was waiting for it to start with to see if both Garter as well as Triple H were able to get themselves, like, stuns and Fey Bolts and other things in combination. Because then you just use the Arcane Boots. This stacking is not meant for you. And he's actually taking a lot of money from that. That's nice of Darkseer. He doesn't take the experience, and now like an extra Iron Shell. He can't kill the Dark Troll Warlord Summoner. Not with that Iron Shell, because he needs to stick around for it. But Ancient Emperor should be able to take a little bit of this. But initially that would have been meant for the Bristleback. That would have been his burst farm with Quills. Would have been very easy to do. Now, Darkseer's level 5, 3 points up an Iron Shell. I'm not quite sure about this. Like, he's walking in and then just surges away. Okay, he put an Iron Shell on the creep wave, which drags him off the tier 1 tower. The Wraith King is also moving up towards the top lane too. So they're coming in to defend this tower. 222 life points, it's not within deny range. So if they are going to be serious about this, they're going to have to keep people up here. Either that, or they make sure they kill the Bristleback. With an Iron Shell on the Wraith King, he could possibly just walk in, go for a stun, try and get a kill. But with Dazzle in the wings, they're not going to actually get the kill because the Shallow Grave will protect him. Now, Hellfire Blast, okay, this could work. We've got ourselves a Pugna coming in. Decrepify, drain the ward down as well, and the Shallow Grave will be used. They hold the tower, and a single point of damage was taken after that point. Not for you. The Acid Spray has gone off right now from the Alchemist, but this Lycan, he's just short of the mana to actually go to an ultimate form. And with the DD rune too, we could have really been looking to just go on the Alchemist. Because Alchemist doesn't have enough to really fight him. He's got enough mana for like that. And now, yep, this. This is what we're waiting for. DD rune, cold feet. Okay, so getting blocked up by your own wolves. But the wolves will come in, he scouts them out into the tree lines. The DD rune will still stick with him. And now he's actually going to get himself a double kill here. That, you could see it coming from a mile away, or at least we could see it. I don't think the Happy Boys could actually see up the hill. But that Lycan was just like the teeth dripping with saliva. As he knew exactly what he wanted to munch on. And craving satisfied. Rubik's also getting all the space in the world now for his farming up in the bottom lane. And Happy Boys, they got real problems on their hands. Like, you've now got a Lycan who went Vlad's first, no boots. Didn't really need boots, because he's getting his movement speed from his ultimate. But now he can pick up the boots anyway. As well as an Invis rune, so he's going to get all of his mana back again. The top tower at least does go the way here of Happy Boys. And the Bristol back's looking quite decent. How are we looking for net worth? 3.4K. Obviously, with the double kill solo in the middle lane, the Lycan will be leading the charge. He's sitting at 4.1K. I'm wondering, actually, in this game, too, like, what kind of build this Lycan is going to go for. Like, if we just go, like, treads, BKB. I kind of almost want to see him. That's not even with, like, that's not HAL damage. That's not DD damage. That is purely a basic right click coming out from a Lycan that takes away, with two hits, half of the life points there of the Alchemist. Alchemist obviously only has two armor, and that's why I was like, I'm wondering where it's going to go into. Like, you could build into treads and then go Desolator, but with, like, so far, he could even go, like, okay, he could go into a BKB, which means there's only the Batrider Lasso which can control him. That's it. I'm just interested to see how he goes. The other option is he can go for something like an Armlet. Let him fight a little bit earlier on. But he'll definitely want to have strength treads if he's doing such a thing. As Darkseer is coming over to check out the jungle, see if there's any more stacks which he can just steal. The Dire left a very defensive observer ward here, so they can see when he does such a thing. But they can't do anything about it, because Lycan's forcing out their T1 tower in the middle lane. His damage output's already amazing, and now he's going to go in again. Now, an Alchemist, he's got enough mana for a concoction, but that's basically it. Carving through the tree line, try and juke him around here, but then a Telekinesis is going to drop down. He's already on the sidelines. Ruby's come in. Now with that kill also, he's at level 6. Surge away by 3, so he evades that, while Pugna continues to add more pressure towards this bottom tower. The Nether Ward's down, so every single time there's a napalm from the Batrider, he's taking damage from this, and he's not at a point where he's anywhere near. Actually, he's near a Blink Dagger, but he doesn't have the Blink Dagger, so he can't initiate it. He's getting sick of this Nether Ward. Are they going to Decrepit Fight and keep it alive? No. Time's out anyway. But this Pugna with Buckler almost finish up the mech. Decrepify, Hellfire Blast will go, Drain with the Blast, and that's the, I say Pugna Blast instead of actually saying Nether Blast, I don't know why. Hello, Lycan Wolves. Hellfire Blast inside of Luffy, with the Lycan Illusions too. They get the heal off, but with Vampiric Aura as well, as Vlad's. These guys have so many life points, it's not funny. Like, it's only one point up of Vampiric Aura, but again, the Nether Ward is down, so again, they cannot fight. Rubick, Arcane Boots time, you bet your Nelly. They need all the mana in the world to keep on pushing. I am interested about this, though. This kind of looks like LGD. They're coming in with, like, a very distinct purpose here. So you're getting a full mech to come out from the Pugna. At the same time, you're actually building into a pipe over on the Darkseer. They're really looking to breach the high ground. I was talking before, like, at the start of a draft, that the Nether Blast is all about going high ground. Like, it's all about breaching the early towers. You need every outer tower gone by 15 to 20 minutes. And then everything from that is all about going high ground. Alchemist, you're dead. Yeah, she triggered his chemical rage at the last moment then, but it's just a full waste. Lycan triggered his ultimate, but he's already running in towards the middle lane, and he's going Necro Box. Yeah, this is a perfect timing, and now he's going to see the Courier. Surprised he didn't just have a run for that. He sees Ancient Apparition. That wolf was in range for a moment. Okay, they're going to come in and take Roshan. They also stole the Acid Spray. Rubick has Acid Spray, so they can go in and take Roshan very, very quickly, but Dire's actually not going for it. Is under attack. Suppose with the Batrider, it is still very risky, and they don't know when he has his Blink Dagger, which is now. It's coming out in the Courier. The TP Scroll as well. But this Bristol pack trying to defend the top lane. And just a simple rotation up here, and this Tier 1 tower is gone. Okay, as Lycan. Okay, we get the Meg coming out as well as his Necro Book. I was wondering when they were going to send these things out. May as well have it now. Looks like also the, yeah, the Hood of Defiance is done. He's only, like, he's only 200 or so gold away from having that full pipe done. And now they finally, like, it took some time, but they're going in for Roshan. As far as I realize, the Acid Spray is about the time. Actually, no, it's only halfway through its duration time. The negative 3 armor over on Roshan. Easiest kill. With Vlad's and Vampiric Aura, it was going to be easy anyway. With the negative armor coming out from the stolen Acid Spray, it was just a simple hit. This creep can't kill. 19 life points. Someone, Darkseer, go finish the tower. Actually, he's coming to mid. They'll let the creep wave do it. Yeah, that's the reason why. He left an iron shell on the creep wave, which means he'll push into the tower. If someone from Happy Boys goes up there to try and defend it, it works better for LGD. Because then there's less heroes to come and defend this mid lane. So the top tower goes down just as a basic creep wave with the momentum fallen. Because of the Darkseer. That nether ward is a little bit too close towards the tower. But because the tower takes forever to kill it off, hero attack, it only takes three hero attacks to actually bring down that nether ward. Blink dagger, now going to come in on the Wraith King, dragging him back. But he's got Ankh. The Weave will come up, which is actually gonna be really, really nice. But Bristleback taking up a lot of this damage already. And they've managed to kill off the Wraith King. Actually, where did his mana go? He had 10 stick charges, but never used it. Now, Darkseer Wall will go down as well. And we'll see if the Radiant Slayer can try and fight up against this. The Pugna Blast just keep going. Pugna draining the life points out there of Luffy and Alchemist. He's trying to kill him off in the meantime. Now, Lycan can finally get back in the fight. He's already used the Howl. Haste Rune's also on that Lycan too. Doesn't really make much difference when he's got that ultimate fall up and running. But the Bristleback, he's down for the moment. They keep this pressure in. Batrider. That's an interesting blink dagger down. He's trying to Firefly down the creep wave, but he's being dragged back into it for another Fade Bolt coming out from the Rubick. He also needs to find himself another steal. But they get the tower. It's 6-2. Wasn't the cleanest engagement there by LGD, but the Batrider is always going to make that a little bit more messier than you'd think. But that Lycan ended up just standing like in the middle of the wall, going, who do I hit? But it's still a win for LGD. They got one remaining outer tower to bring down. That's the tier 2 tower in the top lane. So they can just force that one out. I'm really surprised that the Garter just went straight down. Like, I'm not even quite sure what burned out his mana, because there's nothing on their lineup that burns the mana, so it must just been like knowing how much you've got. Like, he threw out two Hellfire Blasts? Even then, that's like, yeah, that is too much. Yeah, it's 280. Yeah, you need 420. Need 420 mana to throw out two Hellfire Blasts and still have your ultimate available at the moment. And now Hellfire Blast. Bristleback, they got to try and take it from the front, but just pick him up, throw him down, drain him out. We've got Nagin Imceptor Pill coming out from the Pugna as well. And okay, that's a really nice thing for a Rubick to steal, especially a Rubick who has Arcane Boots as well as an Urn. It's because it's basic regeneration. But now you've got Quill Spray coming out, so you got the extra stack damage coming out from Quill Spray with the Rubick. They're going to lose themselves around, and that's what the smoke's for, so they can come in behind. So Surge in one, and they go on the Alchemist. Now, he actually did a really nice dodge there with his ultimate, dragging him back out again. The Aeon is on the way in here. It's going to fall in, actually on target on LGD, and the Alchemist Shell of Grace letting him stay alive for now, but then another stun from the Hellfire Blast. Alchemist is still alive, but at the same time, it's a Batrider for a Rubick. It's a trade-off, and Dazzle is a long way from home. There's no drain ability available for the Pugna right now, which is causing him some problems. So sticks around for a Pugna Blast. But then Meg Charge from Bristleback, Wraith King ulti, and now he can turn in for the drain. He's doing it on the Dazzle, who's already slowed up, and this is allowing maybe to get a little bit more life points back in again. But, okay, three heroes down, Rubick's still down, like it was deep inside the base. He'll TP back while Concoction stuns himself. Darkseer, you don't want to go on that. Actually, he probably can. There's still Hellfire Blast available. And with Iron Shell damage as well, yep, Hellfire Blast, bring the Iron Shell in close. The Darkseer Wall comes up again. And with Pugna Blast, Nether Ward down, the Alchemist, he can turn in for a stun at the moment. But at the same time, I can suppose the Wraith King can just turn himself in again too. Okay, he's dead. No ultimate available. The Aeon is coming out. Now, Triple Three is going to walk directly into this, but it's a level 1 Ice Blast. The initial damage isn't enough to make him fear about the Shatter. But 10-4 on the board. LGD maybe losing a little bit of focus as far as like their mission objectives go, because they've still got to bring down the towers. This gold graph, while it's 12,000 in front, and you'd be like, oh, just want to type GG right now, rare, secure kind of thing. It's not actually telling a correct story. Because you have to remember that right now, LGD are 4 towers up. So there's a lot of money that came in from that one. The only thing that really matters in this game is actually going to be experience and the survivability of the cores of H boys. Like, of course, at the same time, I'm going to say that money is going to very good work, very good use. It's coming out from the Necro books, and until a BKB is actually up and running over on the Bristleback, I'm really concerned for him, because like you can get through. Like, we were talking about this, I think, 2 days ago when we were casting the C-Deck competition as well, and we talked about like Bristleback being a great counter heroes like Brewmaster. Because he just, like, he Quill Sprays out and the Brulings just disappear. The problem is the same thing happens up against Necro units. So you can actually find yourself taking a lot of damage which you were not expecting to take on the Bristleback. And the mech will not be enough to keep you alive when that happens, especially up against level 3 Necrobox. And they're getting really unlucky with their movement at the moment. If they were only like 2-3 seconds earlier, they would have had themselves like a kill over there on the Lycan. Because it would have broken the smoke and they would have instantly like thought, okay, we're coming up this direction. Lycan is here, which means Firefly, Blink Dagger, Lasso, then have themselves a kill. LGD, they're back to mission objectives. Push out the top tier 2 tower.
Middle tower is under attack.
Now the ward is set up in case H-Boy is trying to defend this. Jaeger's about to be reclaimed as well, so we may as well spam out as much of his mana as possible, because there's regeneration kicking in. So Aegis is lost right now here for maybe. But they're going to take a tier 2 tower. He's got enough money to finish up the full Aghanim Scepter as well, which he buys up instantly and flies out. But they pop Necro units, and they're going to try and force top tower. Now, Nether Ward's still down for another 10 seconds. But with Iron Shells and Necro units, way! Hellfire Blast and Telekinesis Bat Rising way too deep! H-Neprishnoti will pump out, but at the same time, you got Necro units, Lycan copies. They all come high ground. Force out the defense here from Happy Boys. The Batrider also bought back here, so it's a double win. They'll lose the Nether Ward, but there you go. There's that burst damage I'm talking about, which can just be unexpected. When you take out those level 3 Necrobooks. Alright, so it looks like Happy Boys, they're coming out. That Alchemist is actually going to build into an armlet. I'm kind of happy with this. This is going to allow him to actually be a contender on the front lines. But he has to be very, very careful about this. While Bristleback is actually going to go into a Vanguard. So he'll just try and go for the survivability. They've still got a massive problem with the Lycan. Like, Lycan is double the net worth of any of the cores of Happy Boys. They need to find more money. They need to find more experience. They need to find a win on a team fight before they get like cramped in the base. Now I said 20 minutes, all out of towns must be gone, and everything else is about pushing high ground. Well, we're already at that position for LGD C-Deck. Like, you've got Aghanim Scepter mech, you've got Pipe already up and running with a Blink Dagger initiation for the Darkseer. The only thing he's missing right now is that fourth point up in VAC, so he doesn't have as much control as he would have liked. You got a Blink Dagger over on Wraith King, who has his ultimate up and running with 7-1 charges too, and they're about to jump on mid lane. They're surging at the Wraith King so he can get himself a stun. Unfortunately for him, he cannot reach the Ancient Apparition. But Lycan's coming in too with 3.4k gold. Please spend your money. Like, even if he's just going to go into a BKB, he can buy the Mithril Hammer as well as an Ogre Club right now. Or he can finish up Treads and pick up the Ogre Club, so he's got more life points when he dives underneath. And if he's going for Assault Cuirass, he can pick up the Plate Mail, so at least then like, you're racking up your extra armor. The only other thing he could potentially be doing is like something like a Radiance, but you're 21 minutes into the game with already level 3 Necrobook. You know what you want to do, and Radiance is not it. That's the only other reason why I could see him saving up the money, unless he's just wanting to buy a straight BKB. He's like, oh, all of a sudden, surprise! Which is going to happen to Luffy right now. Like, how are they? They have Observer Wards, they were looking at him, they had 3 heroes behind it, but they didn't want to jump. Okay. Lycan Wolves again are applying more pressure towards the top, but at least Alchemist now has his armlet up and running. Of course, this is going to basically dry out the buybacks. As you can see right then, you got 3 buybacks available for LGD, and you got 0 available for Happy Boys, and hello. You saw that. The ping's coming out. There's a ward over next to the secret shop, which definitely scattered out the fact that LGD were coming down to him. Towards him, and that's why he's just blinking down. He's fire flying up as much of the creep wave as possible. This is just a relieving of pressure coming out from the Batrider. He should just blink himself, TP himself away to safety right now. Blink, deeper. Can they see him? Can they see him in time? They can see him. The Hellfire Blast, too late. With the haste room from the Wraith Kick, he was moving really quickly to try and catch up to him. But it buys some breathing room here for Happy Boys. I'm down for this. But this doesn't. Haste rune again. Blinks in. He's got to Shallow Grave himself. It's the only way to survive this one. But they'll turn in to fight this. And with Luffy also coming up, they actually drag back Garda. He's still got his ultimate available, so if he goes down right now, everyone else gets slowed down. But the Darkseer Wall have actually split the fight up too. Lycan, in the meantime, has actually managed to kill off. Actually, he's just in the back lines. He did buy the straight BKB. The blink away from the Batrider, nicely done, juked it around with a Firefly up on top of the cliff. But the weave damage is already, the weave effect is there, but it's going to wear off in just a couple of moments' time. So there's a lot of negative armor on LGD. but they can add some harassment damage to this tier 3 tower. Remember, chip damage works perfectly for a Pugna, and Lycan's doing the same thing. So they're actually splitting up the Alchemist, like Necro units plus Lycan, pushing in the top lane, while they actually... Oh, wow, that's a nice combination. Telekinesis pickup, you get your Feybold damage with the Acid Spray, which has been stolen, of course, and then a Hellfire Blast with the Decrepify. So you're getting everything which is basically buffed up, and now they go in again. So, Batrider getting stunned up by the Wraith King. He doesn't have ultimate, just being over-aggressive here, but with the drain that's coming off from the Pugna, looks like Flamebreaker, she's just stopping that for a moment. They're coming back in again. Another Hellfire Blast, and they just drain the Alchemist. Shallow Grave will be there, but he's still inside the stolen Acid Spray. At least I believe that's the stolen one. He's armor toggling it up, looking for another concoction. The Wolf is right behind him, but the Wolf will actually keel over, and Lycan goes for the primary. He's going straight for the Dazzle. Even that damage coming out from him. Easy kills. They're lassoing him, dragging him in. Lycan, dies to the well. Pugna's trying to bring down the towers in the meantime. Fortifications available in 5 seconds time. So they may not be able to finish this job. The Nether Ward is still down though, so if Luffy does come in close, he's gonna still be careful about this. Hellfire Blast, Pugna draining his life points. Oh, we've seen this before. And of course with the Aghanim Scepter, where you stop draining life points, you start draining mana. Which is even worse for a Bristleback. Like life points actually just convert to the mana. And in they go. Back, looking for the extra stunt. It goes on the Batrider. The Pugna again, finding more drains. Just doing this from range. Just keeps it going. They need a little bit more life points here for the Darkseer. He's already got, he's got six stick charges. Shallow Grave will protect the Ancient Apparition, but because he's dragged back so far, the chance of survival is so minimal here. They were looking for a kill maybe on the Wraith King as he got very, very close to a low life. But Luffy, the mid-racks have been taken down. Again, Decrepify, dragging you back. Four start back down again. The stun's going to go over on the Rubick, but he got Cold Feet. Stolen and then triggered into the Alchemist. He got dragged back in again. It's GG. 25 minutes in, the breach just continued. They couldn't bring down the Pugna. Every time they tried, he just drained the life points, the mana back up again, fueling the fire that was the LGD C-Deck push. And that's going to be victory to LGD C-Deck. So congratulations to the boys. They will be able to tie themselves for first position with HGT. And they'll go up against, actually not HGT tomorrow. Our games do continue tomorrow. Again, 13 CEST is going to be the starting time for those matches. We have Speed going up against LGD, and then HGT will play up against Happy Boys. They're the two games for tomorrow. And then on Monday, we have HGT versus LGD C-Deck and Speed versus Happy Boys. They are the remaining four games for Group 2. So I hope to have your viewership for those games. We'll be having ourselves a great time casting them too. So thanks for watching youtube.com/joindota for all the VODs. You can check them out there, and the rebroadcast will be coming up shortly. So thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys back here either tomorrow or enjoy the rebroadcast.